family.
Hi, good evening. Welcome to the family. My name is Nicolas. I'm one of the co-founders of the family. Our business is to invest in very early stage startups, deploy for them an infrastructure to help them succeed in their first steps on the market, finding their market, finding their early users, gathering enough data to be able to raise funds from more traditional investors at later stages. So this is our office. We have this huge space here to host our own events. There are a lot of events here, not every day, but almost every day. And it's very important for us when we produce an event to be able to host it in our own office with to affirm our culture and our brand. So welcome. This event tonight is a panel discussion about talent in Europe. The opportunity we see is the recent publication of a report by Balderton Capital about the talent landscape in Europe. So we'll hear more about that from James. So I'll be joined on stage. Please come with me on stage by two entrepreneurs, the CEO of Aircall, Jonathan here, and Pierre, the CEO of Side, and James, who's a partner at Balderton Capital in London. And we'll start right now to discuss about talent in Europe with, I thought that it was best to hear first the entrepreneurs. They're the one confronted who have to tackle the challenge of finding the right kind of talent, hiring the best people, retaining them in times of hardship, which is often in startups, and also competing with other employers to make sure they attract the best people. So, Jonathan, why don't you start? Please introduce yourself. Tell us a few words about Aircall and talk to us about your experience with talent.
All right. Hello, everyone. So I'm Jonathan. I'm one of the co-founder of Aircall. So for the one that do not know what is Aircall, we are a phone based on the cloud. So we allow any company in the world to create their entire phone infrastructure in a minute. So we can we have like companies that have big support team, big sales team, and we integrate in their office work with their CRM, with their help desk, or anything else. So basically, in terms of talents, it's very hard when you're a startup to attract very different kind of people you look for. So I think the hardest, and everyone knows it probably here, is the tech people, because everyone wants them. They're high value to a company. They're expensive in some cases, less in others. So it's very hard. You have to convince them that your company is better than the neighbor one, which is not always easy. And they're, in my opinion, many devs are like not super loyal, because they like to change kind of work all the time. They want to have special project they enjoy, and not like boring projects. So, you know, it's a very hard thing. The other kind of job that I think is hard to recruit is all the kind of product managers. It's a very new kind of job. It didn't exist maybe like a few years back, like maybe 5-6 years ago. So attracting those people is first, you need either you find them in other companies, which is the easy way. And I think in many other cases, there is also people that are junior coming from other kind of job, but they're willing to do that. And I think it's this kind of people that you have to get out from like regular companies where they used to work for years and tell them, hey, you've been doing like a pretty similar job in this big corporation. You could do an amazing job with us, and you know, you will grow with us. You will participate to an amazing adventure, which, in my opinion, a big corporation can't offer you. So yeah, that is pretty much it. What I would say in my case.
Thank you, Pierre. What do you want to, don't you offer us some feedback?
So, hi, I'm Pierre. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Side, Side.co. So we're inventing the future of work. We are offering a new way to work to companies with a qualified, flexible workforce on demand. So when you go on site, you can find people to help you do your customer support, do your logistics, help you do be a shop assistant in a retail store, for example. And so we are qualifying thousands of students and young graduates today who wants to work flexibly in companies. And we are connecting this workforce, qualified workforce, with companies who need a flexible workforce. So we've been around for a year now, and we are in Paris and in London. We are a team of 25 people with a great product team, sales team, and operational teams. And as Jonathan said, the product team is a hard one to hire, because today the talents are very rare on the market. So we had to do this first, and it was quite difficult. I'm 25, by the way, so I had no experience in a company before, and I didn't know how to hire. So we had to learn that, and I had to learn that successfully today, I think, but making a lot of mistakes. So we learned a lot of things about hiring on the talents in Paris and in London. And so yes, many things to talk about tonight. Very excited to tell you more about the challenges we've had and the learnings that we've had at site.
Thank you, Pierre. James, thank you for being here. So you just covered that topic, talent in Europe, through an interesting report that you can all find online if you didn't read it already.
Balderton.talent.com. Okay.
Absolutely. So tell us about the main findings of the report.
Yeah, so first of all, let me tell you why we did it. So we're an early stage venture fund. We invest across Europe into companies like Aircall, in fact, which is one of ours, hopefully one day side as well. And we invest at Series A stage, which is somewhere between, anywhere between $1 and $20 million of investment per company. But actually, on average, it's 5 to 10. And the reason why we did this report is because we feel that talent is the single asset that defines the success of a company. And we are ultimately recruiters. That's what we do at Balderton. We invest about $100 million a year. We do that into, say, 10 to 15 companies. And so that means every year we have to make 10 to 15 hires of about $10 million each. And we expect those people to build the most important companies of their generation. So we have to be really good at hiring. So that's our job. And then we have to believe that those people are going to be really good at hiring. Because the only way you really are successful as a technology company is by having the best people around you. And not just the best people in your town or the best people in your country or even your continent, but the best people globally. Being first to market, I say, is for fishmongers. You know, it's not about being first to market. It's about being the best in the market. Having the most capital can help, but in the long run, it's not a competitive advantage. And even technology, obviously, while that's the core of what every company is doing, building that technology, managing it, and innovating is as much a challenge of hiring people as it is a challenge of coding. So that's why we wrote this report about how technology companies hire, find, maintain, and retain people across Europe. And we looked at about 15,000 employees across Europe and looked at their backgrounds, and then compared ourselves to different ecosystems across the world. And there's some very stark things which are quite unique to Europe. The backgrounds of a lot of people in Europe are often not other technology companies, as is the case in, for example, Silicon Valley. So if you look at the top 20 companies that people within organizations within Europe used to work at, only about half of them are tech companies. A lot of them are accountants or consultancies or financial institutions. And that differs by country as well. In France, a lot of it is straight out of university. In the UK, it's often out of banks. In other parts of Southern Europe, it's actually out of retail. And also, obviously, there's big pay differences. So on average, a developer in London, for example, until our recent small issue of our currency happened, you'd get paid about 80% or 70% of what the equivalent person would get paid in the Valley. But across Europe, that varied by 4 times. So a developer in Portugal got paid very differently to a developer in London. So we looked at the macro situation and thought, wow, there's a lot of differences here. But the one thing we did learn, the one thing we wanted to discuss more today, and hopefully these two entrepreneurs can bring out, is that the processes that you build to hire people are just as alive here in Europe as they are in the most successful funds in the Valley. And so the big thing we're here to push is ultimately to give people advice and give them money to help bring some more of those practices over here today.
So my next question will be about the competition. So you mentioned the companies from which startup employees come from, so depends on the country. In your experience, how is it easier to hire someone who's already working in the startup world? Is it are there certain spots that we should explore for with people who are bored in more traditional jobs that could become ideal startup employees? What about the US tech companies? They hire a lot of local talent, either to bring them in the valley or to leave them here, but with very high pay, which is hard to compete with. So in your experience, where does the talent come from?
In our case, at Aircall, we are really hunters. So we really, really go and look for them. We do not hesitate to find the best French tech companies, and we just go and hunt these talents because we are not like really famous yet. People might prefer to go working for BlaBlaCar or any other like a Drivee or WeCar, like very big companies that everyone knows. We are a B2B company, so it's not like everyone knows it. So we are hunting a lot. Recently, maybe some of you saw it, we are so willing to hire like these kind of profiles, technical profiles, that we made an advertising in the metro for hiring. Yeah, it might sound crazy, but we did it. And actually, we got some very good like hires from that. Some people were just like sending us an email and say, hey, I saw your ad. I think it's amazing. So that's our way to do it. And we tried also to hunt from like kind of traditional SSEEs, companies where, you know, there is a lot of tech people, so more from another kind of like tech. And unfortunately, we could convince them to join us. That was fine. They were like, yeah, we want to change the way we work. I think startup is great, blah, blah, blah. But at the end, we were not convinced by them because they were not fitting in the culture. They were more like going for a job, just a job. They were not here like for an adventure. And what we always wanted at Aircall is that every single person we hire, we want them to be part of the adventure. We don't want people just come at 9 a.m. and leave at 6 p.m. I don't mind if they do that. But what I don't want is that they count their hours and they just here for a job. Even though, of course, everyone needs a job. But it's just a kind of mentality we look for. And we couldn't find it anywhere else that in young talents for now and in people that are already in startups or kind of startups.
Which means that when it comes to technical talent, we used to say that we French people, that we have a lot of engineers, a lot of developers, we have a long tradition of excellence in engineering. But in fact, most of those people, as you suggest, are happy where they are and not ready to fit in the startup world.
I mean, yeah, we have a lot of engineers, that's true. We have a lot of these kind of people, but we don't have so many like real developers. I mean, we have the 42 school that opened like a few years back, but there is few schools that are doing that, and we don't have a real big like background of people like we can get easily. So they all have jobs or they're just not willing to work for a startup. So it's a pretty, pretty hard thing.
Thank you. So Pierre, where did you find your talent?
At the beginning it's very hard because no one knows you. And so you don't have inbounds of people coming to you saying that they want to work for you. So you have to hunt for talents. And you have to convince. So that's a great thing because nothing is more powerful than the story that you have to tell. Nothing is more powerful than your vision. And I think that the people who joined the team at the very beginning or a few months ago are still here today because they strongly believed in what we were building. So this is the kind of mentality that you have to be looking for. So it's strong belief in your vision, strong belief in the founders, the founding team, and Also, I think that youth is very important because for a long time, you'll have to give everything you have to make the company succeed, and not only the founders, but the first people in the team until, I think, 2 or 3 or 4 years. At first, it's important that you have people who are very hungry and who want to work a lot, to learn, and to live this great entrepreneurial experience. The difficulty is to find the talents who are available and attracted to what you're doing when no one knows what you're doing. So it's something that you're like alone in this city trying to desperately try to find people who want to work for you, and you have to hunt. So you have to choose, go on LinkedIn, go on profiles, send cold emails and see how it goes. And also through referrals, through the family who has helped, through friends, through your personal network, of course it works. And the first people who joined the team were friends that we considered as people that we really wanted to work with, and that we considered as very great people professionally speaking. And then, the hunting part, the sourcing part is very very tricky. But at the beginning, I wouldn't say that Facebook, Google, and these guys are the biggest competitors. It's just giving your energy to find the right people and sourcing the right guys at the very beginning. I think that there are different competitors depending on the different stages of the company.
So what about you, James? You have a European perspective as an investor in all over Europe. Where's the pool of talent, and what are the arguments to make them work for
Yeah, so we break it down a little bit by the different types of expertise and skills needed, right? I think there has to be an overlap of both the technical expertise, whether that's marketing or engineering or sales, with, as both people have mentioned here, the willing to culturally adapt to work in a different mindset. And I know that TheFamily does some great programs here to help people understand what that's like. I highly recommend, by the way, maybe you guys already do this, but when our startups do hiring, as well as a technical competence score, we always have a values score. So we could interview the best engineer in the world, but if they didn't meet the values that are core to the company, they wouldn't get through. And that's really important, not just because you want to hire people with values, but also because you know that person is unlikely to stay, and also unlikely to enjoy the work if they don't meet those values and don't match the kind of criteria that people are looking for in that set. So I think, first of all, there's a question of where do you find those people who match culturally? And some of that is events like this. Some of it's around the community and the hub. And I think that what Europe's getting better at is building up networks of people who show interest in their ecosystem, get involved in it tangentially, start to understand it more, and then we'll move into it. The big problem that we have, I think, is the European technology center is split across many cities, whereas in San Francisco, you can walk in and ask your barista what he thinks about your startup idea, and he'll give you a very detailed explanation and probably be able to write in Python. Here, we don't quite have that density. And so what's really important is we build up density online and across communities to help connect people who have that interest so they understand that cultural and value system. Now, the other side is the harder skills, sort of whether it's sales or marketing and engineering. And you can find those skills everywhere. I think that realistically, a lot of the best companies we see do rely on bringing people out of existing software companies, whether they're startups or big established players. And actually, in a sense, for a city to be able to call itself a technology hub, I think it has to be realistically able to attract someone out of San Francisco, so someone who is competing with offers from Facebook or Google on the engineering side, or Tencent and Alibaba in Asia. And there aren't actually that many places in Europe that can regularly do that. We're seeing more of them occurring and finding more of them. And it's the same is true for a great company. I think to be a great company, you need to have the ability to pull talent out of those kind of organizations, wherever those people are in the world, and bring them locally. Now, there are other challenges to that. Obviously, there's capital involved. There's awareness. One of the tricks one of our companies called TickTail used to do is they used to put within the HTML of their site, if you're looking at this, please apply for a job because you're exactly the kind of person we need. So and there's little things that you can do, but a lot of it has to be direct, you know, direct sourcing. And we know it's hard because the best founders we work with spend 4 hours a day hiring. I mean, that's how hard it is. These are people who arguably the person has the most to do initially in a company, and they can spend 4 hours a day hiring on average because that's how hard it is to find, identify and find and convince that talent.
So if hiring and retaining talent is hard, it is a field of innovation in and of itself. So there's a lot of innovation when it comes to spotting talent, to attracting talent, to retaining talent. You kindly mentioned the program we have set up here at TheFamily called Lion, which is designed to attract people working in traditional businesses and have them work in startups. We have discovered that a lot of people are bored in their traditional jobs, but don't really know how to join the startup world. They don't know who to write to. They don't know in which terms they should apply. They don't have the right mindset. So we have a short-term training for them to teach them the mindset and to prepare them to be recruited. And that's a pool of talent in which startups, especially those in the family, can hire. So that's one example of innovation. Pierre, Side is an innovation in and of itself too, because you help startups hire the right kind of talent for certain tasks, which is good for founders who can focus on hiring their core team instead of being dispersed. So can you tell more about that?
Yes, exactly. I think that you want to spend as much time as possible hiring your core team, and you want to spend as less time as possible hiring temporary workers. And actually, you need high quality temporary workers when you're shipping products, for example. So you need to do order preparation. But however, you don't want to interview 50 people a week for these needs. So this is where we help founders and teams save a lot of time. For example, if Aircall is looking for some customer support at night or on weekends, Jonathan can sign up and post a job so that we easily find people who are skilled and available so that he doesn't spend a single second sourcing and doing the interviews and interviewing the candidates. So we're making Jonathan save a lot of time, and this is what we do. So I think it's very important that you focus on building your core team, but you should not spend time hiring contingent workforce. And so this is exactly the pain point that we are addressing. This is a growing trend in the way companies get organized, is considering more and more of their workforce as a contingent workers, and the core team is the real part of the team that you want to have as permanent contract in your team. The rest of the people, you prefer to have them as contractors. So this is exactly the transition that we are building with Side.
So James, what do you see in terms of interesting innovations when it comes to talent? What advice would you provide to startup entrepreneurs if they want to streamline their talent workflow?
Yeah, well, I think we both find this space fascinating because it's so much a part of our job to make sure people hire, and also because there's some really interesting investment opportunities in hiring tools. So I work with a company called Workable, for example, and their role is to make the idea of putting out job advertisements and managing interviews and scoring people appropriately and getting that whole system, onboarding someone, as beautiful as possible, because it's the first touch point you have with a company. So there's some tools out there which are just focusing on speeding up and making sure that the experience of being hired is as fantastic as working at the company is, because it's such an important experience. So a lot of innovation going on there. I think in targeting people well, I think there's a lot of change that's happening in the types of job advertisements people use, targeting that better, literally A-B testing job adverts in the same way you'd A-B test a customer outreach or piece of marketing, because you want to make sure that people who are applying are the right kinds of people before you spend too much time interviewing them. And we're seeing a huge uptick in people from a very early stage in a company building internal training schemes and taking that extra risk of hiring someone who's younger or less experienced or some, you know, from a complete different background, bringing them into a role and training them up rather than going out and finding someone more senior. Because ultimately, if you invest in people in that way, in the long run, it should be more cost effective. And I think you mentioned that earlier about how important that is. So there's change happening in all of those spaces. I think that the one thing that I that isn't tech-based at all that I really, really think is important for people to take on board is that the culture you set incredibly early in the company will last far longer than you expect it to. And I can't tell you how many founders I know who have been running a company for 2, 3, 4 years and then turn around and say, wow, we're only now thinking about what are our company values and how do we articulate those. Wow, we're only now checking that every single person we hire is in line with those values. And wow, we're only now putting in place feedback systems and mentor communities to help all of our employees. I think I've never met a founder who has regretted putting those things in early. And so I think that the earlier your core team is thinking about those processes, which is not necessarily technology-based, there's lots of things you can do, but is more of a personal statement about how you want to build your company. The earlier you can do that, the better. And if you look at some of the world's best technology companies, you know, they change their HR processes over time, but I think the scalability of their technology is just as important as the scalability of the way they work, and such a big part of that is value. So getting those values right early on, I think, is the best, the most scalable piece of non-tech that you can have within a company.
Well, yes, I like the message. It's not. It's more about culture than tools and techniques. So, did you use some innovative ways to recruit at Aircall, or do you do it the traditional way?
I mean, to recruit, we do it like kind of traditional. It's just to attract them. We did it a little bit like in a funny way, as I said before, by putting an ad on in the metro. But then the tech people, I mean, in general, everyone is really trained. All the every month, each team lead is doing a training about its team. For instance, the tech team have an hackathon, almost every month. So they stay late at night and they are working on a specific project they always wanted to do, but is not on our roadmap, for instance. So it makes us do some little stuff and also, yeah, you know, again, make them part of this adventure that we all live and that we are all living at the same time. And that's also what will make, I think, your company successful, is that you're going to have no turnover. In our case, we had zero turnover until now. It's been like almost 3 years we are Aircall exists, and we had no employees leaving. And I think in one company, what makes it successful first is its employee, it's its workforce, it's their process. And so if you lose one part of that, it impacts you way more than you might think. So it's by having those people, train them constantly and make them happy that they work for you, is that you're going to keep them and that you're going to make your company successful.
I think just within the report, we looked at this a little bit, and I think losing an individual and rehiring them costs the average Series A company about 18,000 euros. That's what it costs. So, and it's sort of, that's a huge chunk of money if you think about the other ways you could spend that. And then that doesn't really count the difference in skills of a new joiner versus someone who's experienced. So it's not just something which is bad for you because you feel like you've let someone down. It's just really, really expensive to be bad at hiring.
What are the main problems when it comes to talent in Europe? Are there problems with supply? Do we train enough people with the right mindset? There are problems with demand. Are we able to attract them in startups with the right kind of pay and the right kind of argument? Are there problems of frictions with labor law? In Europe, in most European countries, we have an advance notice. So if you want to poach someone from a from another company, you usually have to wait at least 1 month, up to 3 months, before they can join you. So it creates a lot of friction. Plus, there are the rules when it comes to firing people. Most startups like to fire fast if it doesn't work, but it's not that easy in a European country. So what are the main problems that you observe in your experience or around you in the startup world?
I think that today the market is more and more mature, but I remember that a few years ago, if you look at it from the other side, as an employee who wants to work in a startup, it looks still a bit like a huge jungle, and you don't know where to go, and you think that you can join a very unstable startup that is not performing well, and the same way you can find a very good startup, and it's hard to recognize the good one from the bad one, I think. So I think that now it's so you prefer joining a big brand, someone you know, Facebook, Google, for example, because you know that these guys are good because you've heard of them. And I think that today there is more visibility, and thanks to the family, thanks to the press, thanks to some evolution in the mindsets of young graduates. And so the problem is still sourcing, but I think it's going better. The little problem is that there is not many people who are very skilled, like off-the-shelf skills, you know, that people that you can hire and they bring all the skills. So you oftentimes you have to train and to do long trainings, for example, in sales or in product. There are not that many talents on the market today, so it's hard to find great people to do this. And so also, the legally speaking, the notice period in France are something that is a bit of a problem, because it's a few months. And when you hire someone, you need someone quickly, and it takes time actually to getting the person on board, train the person, and then having someone new ready to go. So I think in the UK it's different. In the UK, there is a lack of visibility, I think, on the profiles. It's very, in France, it's easy to find, you know, if you want to hire someone to do business, you hire someone from a business school. In the UK, if you want to, like, our head of, we have a business developer in the UK, in London, who is an Oxford student in literature, so English literature. And so you have and that's totally normal. I don't know what studies you've made, James, but you know it's the visibility on the profiles, on the backgrounds based on education is very hard to read. So you may hire someone who's doing geography to do sales, for example. So I think I don't know if it's because I'm French, but I think it's a bit harder to read it in the UK than in France. Maybe the same in the US, I don't know.
Before I founded the family, I had an experience as an entrepreneur. I found that the advance notice was the main problem, because you would discuss with someone, inspire enthusiasm to join new startup, and that enthusiasm would have the risk to be exhausted after 2 months of waiting before the advance notice. And I'm not sure you joining a startup should be a rational decision. You have to be caught up in the values, in the culture, in the have the drive to change your work life, basically. So, what about you, Jonathan? What are?
I mean, I really agree with what Pierre says. Basically, in UK, I mean, in all, I think other countries than France, you don't have to have done a business school to do some job. I used to work in the city in London as a stockbroker, and I remember some of the best traders around me, they did history, while we, all the French guy, we were all from business schools doing finance. So that's the first very, very different thing that we have, I think, in France, that your studies will show what will be your future, basically. So it's a little bit different. Concerning the way the way you have those, once those people are on board with you, you know, what we were saying is that you attract this person, in 3 months you're gonna have it. But I think 3 months is like a lifetime in a startup. I mean, 3 months is probably like 1/3 of the life this startup lived, or what, let's say 1/6, but still, it's very long. A lot of things can change. We are in the middle of this situation currently, where we are just hiring like a very, very senior person that is leaving his company. And now, during this, it's been 2 months already, so many things changed, and we are worried when he's gonna come, because we are like, okay, we told him many stuff, and actually all those things changed. So, you know, it can be very tricky in some ways, especially when the person comes from a big group and expects a lot of like rigorosity, so that everything you say is actually the way it is. So it's a big thing in France. I don't know about Western Europe how it is elsewhere, but I know in France it's a problem. And the other thing is, the other way around, when someone actually is working for you, we didn't have the case, but I know a lot of people had the case, when someone works for you but actually doesn't do the job or does it bad, and you know, it doesn't fit in the culture and impacts your company very badly, you have a lot of troubles to fire them. Even though firing, I don't like this word, it's just telling him, hey, doesn't fit anymore between us. So it can be also a big stress for companies, even foreign or companies that will come in France, that I might be scared, hey, in France we cannot fire someone. So, you know, it's a big thing here.
What about you, James? What would you point out as the main obstacles for attracting talent in startups?
Well, I think, so there's two things. There's the main obstacles for attracting talent in startups in Europe is the lack of successful companies we've had. So if you look at the life cycle of Silicon Valley's most successful companies, you can very clearly see the recycling of top talent, right? Someone who started off at IBM, who then went to Microsoft, who ended up at Facebook. It may not be the founders, but certainly a lot of the people around them, whether it's board members or whether it's advisors or mentors or it's early employees, have been through that cycle. And inevitably, Europe hasn't produced as many of those companies beforehand, so there are fewer of them. Now we're seeing that life cycle start to happen. There's plenty of data around the number of second-time founders, third-time CMOs, people who've only ever worked for a technology-enabled software-based company. There's plenty and plenty of examples of that, but there's more generations to come, as it were. Now a generation, the good news is a generation in this industry is very short. It's not 25 years, it's probably 2.5. And so we're seeing that evolution happen in front of us, but we're still behind. And we still need to, I think, have a few more cycles of successful companies which have shown how not only inspired more people to come into the industry, but trained a whole generation of people within that industry. So that's one thing. The other problem that Western Europe has, and US has had less, but we certainly had here, is that our entire employee system is built on a very different type of industry. It's built on some large organizations which would monopolize or oligopolize certain industries. And to restrict their power, rightly so, lots of employee rights were created around them. And the intention of all of those rights is correct. Almost all of them is correct, right? I think my biggest fear is when I look at fast-growing technology companies and they're hiring fast and firing fast, because A, I think they're probably burning lots of money. B, their processes are probably broken. But C, you will not survive as a company if you treat your employees that way. And you will not survive as a country if you allow all employees to have zero rights and it's the employer who has them all and the capital, whoever owns the capital, has all the rights, right? So that's inevitable. But the employee rights system in every Western European country has to go through this evolution from a very different type of industrial setup, 25-year-long careers, guaranteed pensions. You know, not allowed to move companies for lots of different reasons, to a world where we live in a far more fragmented and fast-moving employment situation. And you know, I think the statistic that I'm told, although I'd have to check it, is that the average person at the age of 40 in Europe would expect to have, at this point, 2.5 times different types of employees. I think the next generation, it's going to be 10, and after that, even the idea of a long-term job may start to dissipate for a mass majority of people. It may be more freelance workers, people working in a far less directly associated way with one employer as we recognize it today. So I can't identify one or two things in each country because I think so much of the system needs to change. Obviously, the biggest thing facing Britain at the moment is how we're going to adapt our visa system and how we make sure that we can still access the best talent across the globe, still attract people, and still offer them security and opportunities in a way which doesn't mean that they have to go through a visa process which lasts 6 months and means that our French and German neighbors can outcompete us. But you know, there's lots of other parts of the system, I think, that is broken. I think there's a holistic rethink that's needed.
Is there thought leadership on that issue in Europe? Is the VC community involved in the widespread discussion about the future of work, future of the job market, and so on? Because you suggest it's in your interest for things to change, but with a few exceptions like Emmanuel Macron here in France, few politicians are talking about that.
Yeah, and so I think as well in the UK, I think certainly there is an ear on the ground to what technology companies need, and in Germany, certainly I think most of our we've made three investments in Berlin in the last year, for example. I think all of them feel like there's a discussion going on with government, and I think the European Union has been relatively thoughtful about the process in some respects. I think the challenge. Well, so first of all, let me clarify one thing. VCs, we're not thought leaders, right? We're thought followers. We go and find people with great ideas and we give them money. What we can do is aggregate the voices of lots of technology companies just because we happen to spend our time working with those people. And so I think producing stuff like the talent report that we did recently, and there's many other fine examples of that kind of work across the industry, is an attempt to help aggregate some of those voices and try and start a discussion. But I think there is no hard and fast examples yet of wholesale reform. I think there's piecemeal bits coming. Certainly in the UK, we had a technology visa set up not too long ago, which has proven it is increasingly successful. We had a very good investment scheme, matched investment scheme, which I think helped to some extent to change the angel investing market, so you can pick to individual pieces of government policy which is changing. But there hasn't really been a wholesale rethink yet, and I think whichever European country cracks this first is going to have a very strong competitive advantage in the technology space, at least.
Okay, thank you. Do you have anything to add in reaction to that? Otherwise, we can hear some questions from.
Can I ask one question? And just out of interest and a show of hands here, how many people currently work in what they describe as a tech startup in this audience? Okay, and how many people currently work in a more traditional industry? And how many people are looking to move across? Okay.
How many are founders of startups?
Okay. That's a good sign for the French ecosystem that it's so mixed.
So the question is, are startups willing to pay professionals, intermediaries to help them find talent?
Yes. So yeah, because obviously there is an industry for this, the headhunting industry, and it's big and it's quite useful until a certain size, I guess, because you trade your time against people who are doing sourcing and interviewing for you. It costs money though, and the best kind of sourcing you can have is probably from your internal team. Or recommendations, but for developers, for example, I think it's very, very useful because it's very hard to source developers, or at least we've had a couple of experience with headhunters and it worked pretty well. When we moved to London also, I think it's a good thing that you have someone helping you get the first people in a new country where you don't know the culture. So local headhunters help you really find the right people for you instead of expanding to London, for example, and thinking that you're French and you'll do everything because you're French. you manage to do everything well. I think it's trickier than this. Having the help of local headhunters to expand to other countries is a good thing. Oh yeah, you pay for that. If you have the money, you pay for that. Yeah, of course. It's about 20% of the 15-20% of the annual fee. But yeah, of course you pay. But you save time at the same time.
And do the so headhunting is a quite stuffy industry. So yeah. did they manage to change the way to work for startups to match startup needs?
We have a long story, I think, at Aircall with headhunters. I think there is not a single day these past years that I haven't been contacted by headhunters every day, all proposing me a lot of things. I would say that headhunters is very good for senior people when you're looking like for very specific roles, like let's say you need a VP sales in United States. Yeah, right. But for all like for developers as well, you want like a VP engineering, a CTO, things like that works. For junior, let's say you want a bunch of developers, doesn't work at all in my opinion. We tried, they're sending you several like kind of traditional people wanting to change to the startup industry. And most of the time, it feels like you're more talking with a sales guy than with a real guy that hunts a talent for you. So that was pretty disappointing. That's why I would say it's good for senior people, or at least like experienced people, more than just for hiring your workforce.
What about Balderton? Do you advise your portfolio companies to use the service of headhunters? Do you recommend certain headhunters?
Yeah, so we do recommend certain headhunters. I mean, because all of our companies use them, we try and get feedback on who's good and who isn't, and share that back to people. And obviously, we do try and, in certain countries, negotiate discounts because we can bring a certain bulk of hires, I guess. In my experience, what I've seen the best founders do is identify lots of headhunters, try some of them out, and when they found one person they really like, hire her or him to come in internally and become the head of HR or the head of people. And the reason why I really think recruitment is so important, so headhunters are very, very valuable. I haven't yet found a headhunting firm which is consistent across all of its operations enough to ensure that every time you use them, you always get the same kind of response. There's some exceptional people, there's some less exceptional people. And as a result, if you find one exceptional person, sometimes it pays to bring them in-house. And so I've seen a lot of companies do that, especially once they have what we'd call Series A plus Series B. So once they have enough cash in the bank to start really thinking about hiring as a skill rather than as a skill which they don't have to own themselves, something they can give out internally. So I've seen people do that and take that approach.
First of all, James, thank you for the report. That was very nice to make it available online, so thank you very much. I would like to talk more about the freelance option. And as Pierre explained, you can hire freelancers, even in Paris, for interns or small jobs. I understand that. But what about freelancers for senior executive? What would prevent a startup to hire a senior executive as a freelancer, as freelance, rather than an employee, especially in France?
Okay, the question, if I can sum up, is what about the freelancing model? Is it practicable for even for senior positions or the core team? Did you have experiences? Some developers or designers prefer to work as freelance, even though they stick with you for quite a time.
Yes, I think it's possible to do this. We don't, because we consider that senior people are part of the core team. And we think that product is core for us. It's not just a tool or a way to show that what we do. It's our value. Is in the product, so the product team is in-house, it's part of the core team. And same for senior people. I think senior people should, except if it's for consultancy, where it may be useful, I guess, because it's temporary and you don't want someone full-time in-house for this. But otherwise, if I hire a VP of sales or head of product, I want someone full-time, part of the team, it's part of the core team, it's part of management. Willing to wait 20 weeks for that? I don't really have a choice, to be honest. But in the meantime, you can find someone interim. But I don't know if it's very working, because there's onboarding time. So as soon as the freelancer is onboarded, you'll have the new person come in, I guess. So you have to weigh this, but it's a big friction, honestly. And in your hiring planning, you have to make sure that you source and hire people early enough that you take into account this notice period and then the onboarding period, so that it's two or three months. For consultancy, yes, but for other roles, I wouldn't recommend it.
Yeah, I think in my opinion, we're gonna do it actually soon for like some specific project, because this senior person has a specific skill on a specific industry. You need a person for a few months, let's say. It's great, but hiring like a role, like a permanent role, a freelancer, might be weird, because what will happen after sometimes. In our case, we are hiring like someone as a freelancer in the next couple of weeks to help us on the VIP part, because we do not have any resources on that part and we have no knowledge. So we'll take someone maybe for 2, 3, 6 months, whatever it costs, but it's for a specific project. What do we know is that after sometimes this person, we won't need it anymore.
So what do you think, James? It's a paradox, because the startup world seems to be promoting the freelance model and the self-employed culture, but at the same time, it's considered good practice to hire people full-time to have them in-house. So.
Yeah, so I think it varies by the type of company, and I think that for a huge number of companies, this model isn't only okay, it's probably likely to be adopted far more broadly, where one of your key competitive advantages is actually someone who's a freelancer. However, I think for us, in particular, when we make investment decisions, which is in a tiny, tiny number of companies, remember, who have to be almost non-rational in the approach that they take, I would struggle investing in a company knowing that one of the core team was freelance. Because then I would ask two questions. One is, why don't you join full-time? And they'd say, oh, I don't believe in the vision. And I'd be like, well, why are you here? For an investor to believe that you can outcompete every single person in your market globally and yet not convince your CTO to join full time that's a really hard ask. And for lots and lots of companies, it makes sense. Like I'd say majority of companies, it makes sense for some skills to be modularized. I think for us, I don't think we have ever invested in a team, at least the top 5 or 6 people, of that team, where one of those people was a freelancer.
So, what about recruiting rookies from university, right from universities, without previous experience? Did you have that kind of experience, or were you satisfied with people that you have to train who don't have worked a long work experience?
Yes, it's not easy. It's good. Test for your onboarding and training system. At the beginning, it was hard because we had none of that. Now we have a very clear both hiring, onboarding, and training. So we create content that we put online, and you have like a internal wiki where you learn all the best practices from the company in sales, for example, or for the developer team, or in ops. On the company's culture, et cetera, so that we don't spend time onboarding people repeating always the same thing. Everything is always online. But of course, it's a trade-off. But junior people, if you manage to see a lot of potential, the potential they have, very loyal, I think, and in a great mindset to create an amazing company, because, you know, it's... We've had a lot of junior people, and they have a great ambition. They're really in it. They want to live the entrepreneurial experience. It's just a matter of selecting A players and creating the infrastructure so that they can easily be onboarded and start working together, understand their role, and get free feedback from people who are more experienced. So read a lot, meet people who are more experienced. But it's feasible, and I would even say that it's something that you want to do at first when you hire your first people.
For us, I think I would say most of our developers are juniors. We just hired 2 developers out of the 15 we currently have that have, let's say, 2 years of experience. So everyone is pretty junior in our company. They all are passionate of what they are doing. So they were coding not only at school. Some never even coded at schools. They were doing different projects, like doing like some freeware online and stuff like that. So juniors are really, really, really good, I would say. And as Pierre says, very loyal, and they won't let you down easily. So for us, it was a big, big thing to have all this workforce.
I'm a personal branding coach and communication consultant. And one of the things I've seen for people who want to set up startups and also young founders is that they're not very good with their own personal branding. And what I mean by that is that all the time they're constantly aware that they're trying to convince other people that they want to have a creative startup, they want to enthuse people to be part of their startup, and of course they're convincing many different types of people. But all the time to be conscious of that and to use all the different tools they might have available, for example, LinkedIn or social media tools that are available to all of us, and that each founder, but also each employee of that startup is not thinking recruitment is for somebody special over there on some part of the team, but it's their own personal responsibility and their own personal, I suppose, commitment to the startup, because they want to see the company grow as fast as possible. And another comment I would make is that when I used to work in a big, large corporation, we had bonus schemes for employees, 1 to 10,000 euros, depending on the type of role and type of company and how much money they were willing to pay. But to have bonus schemes for employees that not only is part of their own commitment to the company, but also to have an added bonus scheme to attract, so that all the time on their own social media, also when coming to events like the family, that they're constantly scouting for potential talent. And very quickly, you will get that personal commitment and get new hires.
So there's a trend with a lot of startup founders publishing on their blogs, on Medium, on LinkedIn. And it's considered a good practice to raise attention and attract interesting people. So do you have something to comment on that? Or did you do that? Or in your startups?
No, I didn't. But
are you famous?
Unfortunately not, but I will be soon after this. No, I think it's a very good thing. I didn't just take the time to do it. It requires a lot of time. But of course, I think that writing on Medium or on your blog what your company's culture is, I'm not in a very selling. I mean, you shouldn't sell. You should just describe what it is, because you need to attract people who are attracted by this. And you need to show people who may not be the right fit that they are not the right fit. So it's actually a great way to create your brand, right? It's to attract people who are like you, and to make clear for people who are not like you that they should not apply. So I think it's something that at some point you have to do. But so far I didn't do it because I didn't have the time. It was not my focus. But maybe soon. Hopefully, yeah. I'd love that.
So what about your personal brand, Jonathan? Do you invest in that?
Myself, no. My co-founder did it a little bit. We sometimes write like in specific on our industry. I know we wrote different, like on the telephony industry. We wrote also on Salesforce, on the blog of Salesforce, telling how we work and what's our vision of a company, and what you can expect if you come working for us. But we didn't invest so much time in that kind of thing, and I think it's just myself, I'm lazy probably, but I think it's great. And I read a lot of entrepreneurs that do that, and I am always saying, hey, I should do it. I guess I forget.
So Nicolas, can I just add one point to that is, if I challenge each of you now, do you have on your LinkedIn or social media, even, it doesn't have to be detailed information, but the type of profiles that you want to hire now? It's just very simple on your LinkedIn profile. I'm looking for these type of profiles. Yeah. So it doesn't have to be a long article on Medium or anything like that, but I'm looking for these people now.
I have "We are hiring" on my profile in very big. I think many people have that, so it's not like it doesn't change anything.
It's a bit of cliche in startups. We're hiring, even though you're not hiring, you're forced to.
I think
to
it's been 3 years I have that on my LinkedIn. Now I just realized the thing is that I think there is no startup that is not hiring. In my opinion, especially on the tech side. So you're always hiring. So I guess it's just my remark on that is that in France and probably in Europe too, we have a big lack of teaching coding. So people are not so aware of that. And I think there is a huge, huge gap between us and the US, even though apparently the quality of our developer in Europe, especially in France, and I heard Eastern Europe are the best developers, even though we are better than in US. But there is a big lack here. We say all the time in France, there is no work, we have a big problem with that, 10% I think almost of unemployed people. And I think there we should go. We should just like teach our childs to go to these kind of like schools and avoid like the tradition. When I see sometimes that some people are going to some university, I'm not saying that psychology is bad, but everyone knows in France that if you go to psychology, unfortunately, there is no much work after that. So, you know, we should push people to do this kind of engineering job, which you're sure 100% you're gonna have a work. I never heard a developer having no work. So
it's more macro. So James, one last word. What do you expect from publishing your report? What outcome do you count on?
Well, so I agree that awareness is really important, but I think the most important part of that for founders and for VCs is the right kind of awareness. It's not just people knowing who you are, it's the right people knowing who you are, which is why we published the report, and it's the reason why all three of us are presumably here today.
Okay, thank you very much for participating in the panel. Thank you all for being here tonight. I'm